It was a solemn moment in the history of India. The nation was engulfed in sorrow for its slain leader. Prime Minister Indira Gandhi had been brutally assassinated by her own bodyguards, resulting in the anti-Sikh riots of 1984. It was time for the Congress to elect a new leader, and they would do so unanimously. On the 31st of October 1984, at just 40, Indira Gandhi's eldest son Rajiv Ratna Gandhi would be sworn in as the interim Prime Minister, the youngest ever in the history of India.
When he became Prime Minister, he was heading a caretaker government. Because Mrs. Gandhi was killed, he was sworn in as the Prime Minister. But he didn't stick to the chair. He ordered elections, and in the elections, he was elected with an overwhelming majority.
Born on the 20th of August 1944 into India's most distinguished political dynasty, Rajiv Gandhi did not exhibit interest in politics. Alumni of the elite Doon School in Dehradun, he would meet Sonia Maino at Cambridge University, someone who would play a significant political role in the years to come.
We had gone to a restaurant in Cambridge. This was Rajiv, Arun Singh, a few others, and me. And two or three young women walked in from the door. Rajiv had one look at Sonia, who was one of the three women, and fell for her for then and forever.
Post-marriage, Rajiv Gandhi would choose to focus on his family and budding career as a pilot for Indian Airlines.
Actually, he kept a very low profile before he entered politics. He was known to everybody as an airline pilot. He was a pilot with Indian Airlines, and I think he was trying to upgrade his skills to the Boeing at that time. And he lived a very quiet, normal, middle-class life. That was the perception all of us had. Before he entered politics. So he was seen as a very nice, decent family man who stayed away from politics, unlike his younger brother, Sanjay, who was very actively involved with politics and in working by his mother's side.
It was only after the death of his politically active younger brother Sanjay in 1980 that a reluctant Rajiv would be compelled to join politics at the behest of his mother. A move that was criticized by many in the press, public and opposition, as some saw it as a further extension of dynasty politics.
Yes, I think it's fair enough to say that he was a reluctant entrant into politics. But I think once he plunged in, he did change. He became very proactive in politics. he picked it up very fast.
I do know that he at that time felt that it was his duty to his mother to stand by her because she'd lost a son on which she had come to depend. It did look that the very unity of our country was under threat. But my impression is that they arrived at that decision because they felt that if Rajiv became the Prime Minister, they would lend continuity and stability to the government.
The Lok Sabha being dissolved thereafter, fresh elections were announced for November 1984, and the Nehru Gandhi Science poll pitch was simple. Reminding people of his family's contribution, Rajiv portrayed himself as a reformer. A wave of sympathy swept across the nation. The Congress came back to power with a landslide victory, capturing over 400 seats. This was by far its best ever performance. Rajiv Gandhi would be christened the 7th elected Prime Minister of independent India.
The election that followed was, I don't think it was Rajiv Gandhi's election really, it was Indira Gandhi's election, and the whole election was fought on her cottage, as it were. For the first time, a nation in convulsion, a nation feeling threatened, Khalistan movement was sort of gathering steam across Punjab, Kashmir was in turmoil, and this whole thing was as if India was going to break up. So, and Indira's assassination at that time came as a final and a very shocking blow to people, which is why the result of 1984 was a huge endorsement of the Congress Party, which people thought was the only party which could keep the country together. And of course Rajiv Gandhi had a role in it. I mean he was personally very charming. He brought new hope.
Besides steering the country away from traditional socialism, Rajiv Gandhi brought economic liberalization, introduced information and technology, and nudged India a little closer to the West.
I think his main contribution was to bring hope, especially after what happened to his mother, Indira Gandhi, you know.
He's very much a techno-savvy person. He had in his house a room with the equipment which you wouldn't believe. He knew about things well before they came out in the country.
We did not have a telephone system that worked. We had no computers at all. Computer age had not dawned in India. He was the one who brought computer age in India.
What he did do was to think in terms of opening up the economy. That is why probably many people consider that he was moving closer to the US, because he felt socialism, the form of socialism that we had adopted, had not allowed the country to move as fast forward as it had the potential to do. I made the head, the JS, in charge of administration. So my main task was the computerization of his office. It is not only the computerization of his office, he was looking to the computerization of the entire government of India.
At that time, there was a huge fear that computerization meant that people would be out of jobs. Conversely, the exact opposite happened. The entire IT industry came in and generated tremendous amounts of jobs in India.
He used to say, we have missed industrial revolution, but we should not miss the technological revolution.
Yet his tenure as Prime Minister was mired in controversy. From being accused of using commissions from the Bofors deal to run the Congress, to the rise of terrorism in Punjab. From vote bank politics to sending peacekeepers in war-torn Sri Lanka. Young Rajiv's Congress was quickly losing ground, credibility and popularity.
Sri Lanka is a sovereign country of its own. It was for them to ask us for our help in whatever way they wanted. It is not for us to offer it.
He was rather misled, I think, especially by some of his party men, in terms of how to conduct elections and how to conduct public diplomacy.
Rajiv Gandhi, out of his sort of callowness and political immaturity, went to Parliament and made that famous statement saying, neither me nor any member of my family has taken a paisa in kickback in the Bofors deal. And therefore, he handled it in an immature fashion. And he could not contain the rebellion of Vishwanath Pratap Singh, which grew and grew and grew to a degree when he had to lose his government.
On the heels of the 9th Lok Sabha elections, tension was brewing within the Congress. Soon, several Congress dissidents joined hands to form the Janata Dal, and with the support from various regional parties, the National Front came into being.
It was quite simple in a sense, because there were too many leaders with too great ambitions. Everybody wanted to be Prime Minister, basically.
Within the party, there was disaffection, possibly, but in Congress party, when someone from the family is in power, these things don't really matter. So in the end, Rajiv Gandhi was the leader for the party. That was indisputable. But his handling of the situation, I suppose, could have been better, once again, had he been a better politician.
The sentiment against the Congress was strong.
ये बिल्कुल साफ हो जाता है कि फतेहपुर के अंदर कांग्रेस की जमानत जब्त होगी.
Despite being the single largest party with 197 seats, the Congress had to concede to the National Front. And rebel congressman VP Singh would become India's 8th Prime Minister.
मैं प्रत्यक्ष अथवा परोक्ष रूप में संसूचित या प्रकट नहीं करूंगा.
Congratulations. However, Singh's tenure was short-lived. No sooner was L.K. Advani arrested for defying orders against the infamous Rath Yatra, the BJP would promptly withdraw its support from the VP Singh government. With the help of the Congress, the Samajwadi Janata Party, a breakaway faction of the Janata Party, would lay claim to forming the next government, led by Chandrasekhar, the 9th Prime Minister of India.
You know, the Janata Party government experiment failed for the simple reason that there were too many leaders, and it was not a real political party it was supposed to be, and then it broke up on the question of the affiliation of the Jan Sangh, the old Jan Sangh part of the equation, and that they had to revoke their links with the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh, RSS, which they were obviously not prepared to do, which was an excuse. So it broke up, and then of course, in the famous Hindi phrase, Ek Din Ka Sultan, I mean, we saw a parade of prime ministers coming and going who were in office for short terms.
But in 16 months, India was already bracing itself for midterm elections. By now, the political environment in India had turned volatile. It was being termed the Mandal Mandir elections. A poll plank used by the BJP, the Ayodhya issue had led to riots in many parts of the country, polarizing the electorate on the lines of caste and religion. And with the National Front in complete disarray, the question on everybody's mind was if the Congress could deliver.
These are two very disparate strains in politics that happened to come at the same time. I don't think it was purely coincidental that they came, because Mandal came when BP Singh was in a crisis. People were self-immolating, students were across the country protesting against this thing. There were counter protests by people who were meant to be beneficiaries of the Mandal Commission recommendations. So again, the national pot was boiling.
Well, it held the Congress because the people were absolutely fed up with what was happening on the political front. As far as the Mandal issue was concerned, once V.P. Singh brought it to the fore, it became a real poll issue. And we couldn't go back, the country couldn't go back, because once you raise that kind of divisive politics, it is there to stay because of the caste factors and interested parties and so on.
The 10th Lok Sabha elections were held in three phases. And by the first phase, the Congress, led by Rajiv Gandhi, were campaigning vigorously to stage a comeback.
We were expecting him to come back. I was expecting him to come back as Prime Minister. And he would have been a really great Prime Minister because he had learnt a great deal by being leader of the opposition. I happened, as I said, in interaction with him throughout that period. He understood politics much better.
May 21st, 1991, a day that would be etched in infamy. At 21 minutes past 10 p.m., Sri Perambadur, Tamil Nadu, would be witness to a ghastly act of terror. Amidst thousands of supporters, Rajiv Gandhi would be brutally assassinated by a suicide bomber.
On 20th May, he had returned early in the morning. He and Soniaji went and voted. He voted in the election that morning, 20th morning, and immediately left for Bhubaneswar. From there he flew to Hyderabad. From where he went to Chennai, and from Chennai he went to Sri Perambadur. And that was the end of the story as far as I was concerned.
I got a call on the 21st of May 1991 that Rajiv Gandhi was no more. And there would be a blackout. And that's what happened.
It still brings tears to my eyes, but anyway, that is what happened. That is how it happened.
Left leaderless abruptly, India would be gripped in overwhelming sorrow once again. Rajiv Gandhi's death would steal the nation of someone who could have redeemed himself as a great leader.